Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. We're going a bit old school on this edition of the show. I'm not talking about my technological advances, where I'm still figuring out how to work Zoom after 3 years. I am joined on this edition by old school cool himself, James Blair. Welcome to the show.
Thanking you for having me, Mr. Billy.
I'm glad to have you on. It's been a long time coming. I've seen your name bandied about the territories. I'm finally getting to have a wee chat about Mr. Blair himself.
Looking very much forward to it.
So we'll start with an easy one. Usually I start all the new guests with the boring, how'd you get into wrestling? We will get into that one in a minute, but I think the best one I could go with is just, how's it going today?
Today, so far, so good. You know, I woke up, pot of coffee, worked out a little bit, watched some of the territory style wrestling, woke up with my number one being Squeeze. Doing good. I'll ask you, how are you doing this fine afternoon? Is it the afternoon? I think it's the afternoon.
It's the afternoon as of recording, pulling back the curtain there. All right. it's a Monday as we're recording this. So, it's been a weekend of Crown Jewel and seeing Mr. Galloway lose, even though I bought my network because the internet told me he was going to win, and then realized he didn't, and I was like, well, there we go. Better go watch all the wrestling instead and make up for it for the next month. Poor me. But other than that, can't complain. I've got podcasts to record and I've got guests to speak to. So let's just get into it. How did you get into the wrestling? What was your first memories of the pro wrestling?
Well, brother, it was 19XX, and I remember seeing Andre slam Hogan in the Pontiac Silverdome. It was perfect. But for my serious answer, I do remember when I was a little young, old school cool. I can vividly remember, and I don't know why it's always stuck out to me in my head, but it was the Raw where Shawn Michaels and Cena went, I think it was like 45 minutes to an hour.
Okay.
I can't remember which one that was. I think it might have been 07, if I remember correctly. And I was hooked on it. The way I've described it to other people in the territory and in my circle, I say it was like a car crash. I just had to know what had happened and like why this had happened. So, and then I slippery sloped from there and I've just not stopped since.
2007 then. So how knee high to a grasshopper were you at this point? Just to age me terribly. How old were you when you got into it?
I think give or take, I was around like I could lie and say that I'm 7,000 years old and all that, and I can remember when your dad was shaving. But I'd say I think I was around 6 or 7 at the time, if I can remember correctly. So
that's fine. Just a good 10 years then. That's there. We go. All my joints clicking then. Excellent. Right. Okay.
Don't worry.
2007 then. So that was a pretty good time when it comes to. Because there's so many, like, not weird things, but I was just coming out of the revival of DX as well, and there's a lot of Randy Orton was about, Edge was about, and Undertaker was our pretty good run. So it's probably an underrated time of wrestling when you go back in it. I mean, for me, I'm not one that's taken a break from it. So from 1999, I think, from onwards, I've never been out of the loop, even though people have grown up and have done and come back in. But so was Cena, Michaels, were they your two guys then? Because you had to see what they would do next or what their backstory was. Were they your two favorites?
It was actually the Cena wasn't though, but Shawn Michaels is my pound for pound favorite wrestler of all time. I was captivated by it. Of like, why are these two men doing this in front of this bigger crowd? What's happening here? And then I remember that my parents at the time had seen that, I'd watched it, and then from there, it was the bog standard issue. After watching it, came going to see it, and then like the figures and the games and like keeping up to the loop with it all year round. So, Shawn Michaels has always been probably my favorite wrestler. I remember. My cousin, pulled back the curtain into the life of old school cool, said that Bret Hart was his favourite wrestler, and I'd always poke fun at him saying, "No, Sean's better, still lying." But as I've gotten much older and vastly explored these territories, I've realised that both of them are equally just as good as each other. So I'm not in one camp. I can appreciate the both of them for what they did at the time. So
That's it. They're both the peak at their respective kind of genres of wrestling, whether it's the entertainment side, which Shawn Michaels was arguably the best at it, and then you got the technical side or the nuances, the subtleties of Bret Hart as opposed to like the larger than life Shawn Michaels thing. So yeah, it was all both sides of the same coin, even though people will never want to admit it, and you have to pick one or the other. Think terrible thing in wrestling when you got to pick one side overall. Why can't we all just be friends and like both? That's just I don't think that's ever going to be solved in wrestling. So the figures, I'm always fascinated. Do you remember what your first figure was?
I can't remember, but I can remember I think it was a Batista figure. Toys R Us, I think. It was that. I can't remember what line it was though. It was a bog standard one. I think it was just the Batista with the black trunks. And I was captivated by it, you know, because I've seen him on TV, and I've got like something to like replicate him and stuff. So as a normal child would do at the time, like it was a Batista, and then from there it just fast like it worse like with everything else. We like getting all the figures for like over Christmas and birthdays, stuff like that. Like I do recall that after, you know, like I grew out of having them in my possession. I think I had like three trunks full of them when I was growing up. I just gave them all to my family, like my younger cousins and stuff who were still in it, like at that age. I just gave them all up. Although if I'd have kept them and sold them, I'd have made a pretty penny, so slightly rigid about that, but luckily I've can't change the past.
I'm absolutely the same. I mean, of course, if anyone's watching the video version of this can see that I've somehow amassed a collection of pops anyway. But when I think back, I went out of I went, oh, I'm too old for wrestling figures. I had a massive box. I'm too old for them. And then I sold them. I didn't really care what I got. I think I got like 50 quid for them, which was great. But I was 14 or that, and I thought, oh, I've got £50. Excellent. Fritted it away on nothing. And I would go back and think, oh man, I had a pair of Saturn. It looked so cool. I wish I got that back. I had the original Legends line. I had the Yokozuna. Oh man, I wish I had that again. I wish I had the Junkyard Dog and all these figures that I remember having. And as you say, you can't go back and change the past. But if I knew the address of that person that I sold the figures to, I'd want to hunt them down and go, can I buy them back, please? Here's £50. Can I have them all? Because, oh, they were just ace. I had the NWO, the first, like the. Anyway, I don't know if you remember. Do you know your figures? Do you know your kind of lines of figures? I'm
Yeah,
not hugely aware of them, but.
I think so because I cover vastly all aspects of wrestling, so I can keep on top of it. Because you know, even though I travel all these territories, I'm right nosy. So I'd say, like, I know like certain lines do better than others, and like ones are more sought after. Like I know like the Legends ones or like the Ultimate ones, they do a lot better than the bog standard normal basic ones. I think the Legend series now goes for quite a lot of money. I remember I seen after the passing of Terry Funk, you know, I seen like his Legends figure was selling, and I think I seen this right, it was like £600 like that it was going for, like because I had his signature on it.
Oh man, all that money that I've thrown away because I was too old for wrestling figures. No, I remember the draft ones when the draft came around in 2002, 2003, and they came with a figure, and it came with a contract, a Raw contract or a SmackDown contract. Oh man, I mean nowadays you get extra heads, you get extra hands, but the accessories back in my day were the coolest bit because you got a Al Snow with a head that got pulled. Which I never got because
People
it
had
was
complained about it, but I think
useless.
Mother of the World complained about it. Speaking of accessories, that's why I rock a bandana and these funky sunglasses.
I know we haven't mentioned the funky accessories. My apologies. We've gotten this what a couple 5 minutes in and we haven't mentioned. I used to be a bandana guy. I don't know if that's gonna be a shock to anyone, but talk about the bandana. What like, before we move into other wrestling stuff, bandana glasses is this the style of the time? What's the look?
Well, as I've travelled up and down the highways and all the territories, Alabama, Arkansas, Georgia, Memphis, you know, I've taken styles and inspirations from certain wrestlers and certain people, certain cultures. Rocking the bandana, as it was Harley Davidson. I know quite a lot of wrestlers down in the Mid-Atlantic way. Your Dusties, your Magnums would cut about with Harley Davidsons to compete with one another because they had too much money to throw about. I rock a leather jacket with two extra bandanas tied into the wee. I know it's for. I think the original purpose was it so you could hang a bag there, but I'm like, no, it's a bandana bit for me. And then these glasses I got off of this website called Blank. I was on the line as I was searching. They put the whole idea together, and it randomly came up on Instagram as I was doom scrolling, as I'm famous for, as a Ruby will constantly remind me to do things. They randomly just came up, and I went, they are bitching, was my exact words. And I'd had a look, I'd a look around. There was some right funky ones, and I bookmarked some other ones, you know, for later, you know. But I'd seen the blue, with like the lightning bolts, and I thought that is the single best thing I've ever seen in my life. I need to get them bought, and then I did, and I've not had them off since.
You know what? The phrase "that's bitching" is going to be that is an underrated phrase to use, because you know some stuff is just
Bitchin'.
there's just no other word for it. It's just bitching. That's it. That's why. Are you sponsored by Blank? Out of curiosity,
No,
no. What's your
no.
pitch for
However,
it?
you know, I'm pitching for it. You know, well, hopefully, once I buy enough of their products, hopefully, they see actually this, like, and I can start tagging them and posting stuff as well. And you know, and they see me in different territories. You know, heck, hopefully, they'll be coming knocking at my door any minute now.
Speaking of sponsorship, if anyone does want to get their grooming products, haven't done this to the road to Manscaped ads. Oh my God. 20% off SWN20 manscaped.com. There you go.
I'll keep that in mind.
I'm learning, you know what? It's taken two almost 250 episodes. I've learned how to just put in sponsors, but then I get too excited and then point out that I've learned how to do this now. Moving on then. So Shawn Michaels, that's your guy, pound for pound, the best. You mentioned Batista action figure. Was that when you said your parents took you to a live show? I'm assuming this was Glasgow Brayhead. Do you remember the main event? What do you remember the show? Was it just, oh my God, the best thing ever?
I remember, I'm trying to think because it was a while ago. My memory's not the best. You don't want too many nights at the territory. I'd say, I think I can briefly recall Charlie Haas was there, and it was during that time where he was dressing up as other wrestlers, and they dressed up as Roddy Piper. I know that. I can't remember who he faced. It might have been GBL. I think Matt Hardy was there also, but I can tell you the best show I've been to. I went down to an NXT show in Aberdeen. And I remember it was during the time like William Regal was the GM, Nikki Cross was there. It was good to see somebody from like you know Glasgow, and funny enough, also trained at the same wrestling school I was trained at, so that was a whole other thing there. I hadn't started my wrestling journey then at that point, but it was great. I went with my dad, and it was fantastic. He loved every minute of it. So did that. The main event of that show was Galloway versus or McIntyre, as he's known. And Bobby Roode, it was fantastic.
You know, I'm gutted because my mate went to that one, and I was, because they're a bit pricey, those tickets, and I was like, oh, no, I can't justify going. And he said the same thing. He'd been out of the loop for wrestling in a while, and he went to see the NXT in Aberdeen at the when it was, I think it was still the ACC at that point, and they went to it, and it was, yeah, he said it was the best show ever, and he got a picture of Bobby Roode and all that kind of stuff. I was like, this is I'm gutted, because the last one I went to that tour, the one you're talking about with Charlie Haas. Remember rightly, it was in Aberdeen, the one I was at, and I think it was Charlie Haas and Gene Snitsky that was the match. So, you know, not all of them could be good, but it was a good
Needs
show.
more baby kicking for Gene Snitsky. Needs more baby kicking.
You know what? He did it once, and he should have just made it his whole thing.
Just
Yeah.
kick random objects like.
Oh, that's just been babies, just dead. Bring him back when, this is going to go really badly, but bring him back when, remember the storyline where Stephanie McMahon was pregnant and she had to leave, and it was around about that kind of 2006 time, I think, with DX, you know, just bring Gene in for just a bit of a scare one week and, you know, push the envelope, you know. So from that point then, you're all in. You're all into the wrestling. You get to see Nikki Cross. You're seeing all these live shows, the WWE shows. How much were you aware of the Scottish scene before you decided to take the leap yourself?
I wasn't really, to be honest. I remember. I'd went. I've not. I'd went to. I went to one. It was like at the time, I think I was still roughly in high school back in 1979. I went to go see, I think it was BCW, if I remember correctly at the time, because it was an East Kilbride, like the Ballarup Hall, I believe. And it was a great night. It was a great night out. I really enjoyed it. And I'd seen that, and I was like, oh, there's a scene here and stuff, and that's quite cool. And then, like, fast forward a few years when I was at the college back in the 90s, my friend had mentioned that she was a professional wrestler, or one in training. And I remember, because I'd asked her about it, because like I'd lost quite a lot of weight to do it. I think I lost maybe like 3 or 4 stone in like 3 months. Not the healthiest thing I've ever done. It was all caffeine and cigarettes, but wasted the territory. I got to make it work somehow. And then lo and behold, I think it was 2019, I started my journey at Source Wrestling. Rest in peace, And then it was from there, training hard, getting battered every, I think it was every Wednesday I did it until and then, the big bad pandemic happened, and then that had stopped that then this track, so I had nothing else to do. I nearly took bumps in my back garden at the time, but I thought, no, that's concrete, I'm not doing that. So, as a funny story, as a little wee extra, I was like, right, I need to get back into ring shape, I need to take over these territories by storm. How the hell am I going to do that? And when I was staying at the time, the Iron Grinders gym, it was offering like one-on-ones again, and I went, oh, perfect, fantastic, I can wrestle again. Like, it'll be great. That's that. I went and I said to myself, I know it'll be hard, but you know what, James, you're gonna smash it. I was nearly sick twice, I nearly passed out. I was like, I thought my cardio was good, as I'm standing there dying. But no, I think there's a picture of me like this, sitting on the rope, dying. Like, it's my favourite picture, because I'm like, that's what it's like to be a wrestler, mentally dying there. Then I had to walk like 15 minutes up the road to then go out to dinner. Safe to say, I wasn't best pleased.
So you mentioned losing 3 stone, and that in itself is very impressive. Is it just you say it was cigarettes and caffeine, but was it just watching it and thinking you want to do it, you want to at least try it? Was that the main motivation? Or I mean, I know for
Pretty much.
myself, I'm a big lad, so I'm probably need some sort of motivation to lose the timber. But yeah, so was that just it?
I mean, for me, it was the case that I'd said to myself, I wanted to be a professional wrestler. I wanted to give it my all. I wanted to be the best I could, and want the best that I could for the time. I think I was like, pull back the curtain here. I think I was like 19. Like, I'd literally finished high school. And then I was like, because I remember I weighed myself one morning, and I was raging with myself, thinking, I don't want to look like this forever. Like it really lit that fire under me. Like, I was like, I want to be a wrestler. I was going to the gym every day with me and my friends had went, because we all made a pact together to go. But then those two losers stopped going, and I just kept going, because I was like, well, if they're not going to come with me, I'm just going to go like myself, and I loved it. And then I lost all that weight. I was 13 stone at one point. And then I beefed up a bit, because I was a bit too skinny. So, I sit at a normal-ish weight now. So, I've been told that I'm not allowed to use any like extra like bad supplements. Ruby's put the kibosh on that, so you won't be seeing a old school cool with a massive head like that and shoulders at the bit here. So, all natural is what I'm going with here. So,
Just eating them vitamins and saying those prayers.
yes.
That's life.
Eating vitamins and no taking them roids,
I'm glad you didn't say wait, like what you said, 13. And I've always get worried when people do that and they go, oh, I was huge. I was 17 and a half stone, and I'm sitting here at 18 going, oh, that's huge. Oh, shit. Okay. Let's get a salad for lunch instead, then, instead of so from that point onwards, where Source has there was a pandemic, which everyone found things to do. Yours was trying to avoid throwing yourself onto the concrete to do back bumps. But how did you do the Looking Sharp Dojo stuff? How did you keep yourself occupied and active in wrestling during that time?
At the time, I had realised that there was a LKS dojo. I'm actively a member of the LKS dojo now. King Louis of the Clan Sharp, who runs a really tight ship. He's the classes are every Monday, 7 till 9. They're only a fiver. They're excellent at the Iron Gunners gym. Safe to say he's been a really big help in, whipping my ass into shape and like keeping my cardio up, making sure I'm like hitting like really good, nice strikes and stuff, and like being overall sound professional wrestler, even though he's a scary like little man, but he's a really good coach. I'd recommend the class to any wrestler at any level. But to sidetrack back onto the main point, I kept active in wrestling just by watching it, following what was happening, watching as much wrestling as I could because I had nothing else to do. And I just went running every single day. And I was listening to some wrestling podcasts as well in the meantime to like keep myself busy so I could listen to other people talk about wrestling, to actively like push myself out in the runs because the runs get boring after a while. Running along like the canal and Kirkintilloch, one of the many territories I visited. And it's really keep I'm honestly shocked that I'm going to total boredom. I was maybe like a ball head away from being an alcoholic, but yeah, I kicked that habit, I got clean. And then the territories came a calling back, and then, I like to party, so.
I mean, everyone did the same kind of thing. It was either Twitch, making bread, podcast. That was the three options you had as as someone who calls themselves creative. That's what they did. And I tried Twitch, but I realized I hated the sound of my own voice. So I tried podcasting instead, so everyone else can hate it as well. But it was such a weird time, and we're probably still going to speak about it for years to come. Well, it's been 3 years since it started. And we're still feeling the after effects in wrestling. For yourself, that it delayed your progression. It delayed many people's progression for that year, certainly. But you found your way through things like the Iron Girders, and then you found your way into Looking Sharp's dojo. And I've said it once, I've said it a million times. Looking Sharp's probably one of the best in the country because he has so many what's it, quivers to his bow. Is that the phrase to use? But he's got so many things that you can pass on, acknowledge for yourself and for everyone else. But we'll talk about your debut then. So you weren't quite old school cool when you debuted. I've got it down as August 2022, but that's just as far back as I've got my results for showcases and whatnot for Source. So that was against Adam King. Was that about right? Was that the first time?
Yes, that was correct. That was my pro debut. I'll never forget that day for as long as I live. I remember they peeled like the curtain mark just a little bit. I remember I was staying at East Kilbride at the time, and I'd said to myself, right, I'm either getting here and I'm getting told I'm debuting in August, or I'm not at all. And I said, no matter what happens, you know what? I've worked hard because I had done. I don't think I'd missed like a class at Source. That was a Tuesday, Wednesday. That's what I did. For about 6 months straight, I was there every day, and I remember like running down the match card, and it got to me, and I didn't hear it quite at first. You know the way where you hear something, but like you don't believe it until they say it again. So they'd said to me for video format because they can see me. Like after the day, it was Glenn Dunbar had said it out loud, and I went, me. Me, and then said it again. Everybody clapped, and real men cry. I will always express that real men do cry. I cried my eyes out, and I remember after the class was over, I got home. My ring gear was sat at my front door. It was honestly like the perfect day. And then like I was a different back then. I was running rampant, as they say. So. But the match was good. I think I remember I was on seventh out of like an eight match card, and it was the waiting that killed me because I was like, right, I'm facing somebody who's A, wrestled longer than me, currently wrestled for ICW. I was bricking it, but you know what? I managed to do not bad. Even though I get knee-ed right in the jaw, and that hurt a lot. But a great match, a great show, and all I can remember afterwards is I sat down and think that was awesome. Then all my adrenaline wore off. I'm like, I'm in so much pain. I've never had back pain like this before. But I do it every single day of the week. It was the best feeling of my life and continues to be. Source obviously holds a special place in my heart for being there for so long. I was there on the last show. I nearly broke my neck in the last show. A tornado DDT from Austin Brooks went awry as I was like, oh, I've got this. I'll protect myself, and I did, and then my neck went, and I thought, oh, this is what death must feel like. I remember after the pin, I rolled out to the floor and I laid there for a while, and I thought, I can move, I'm all right, just get up and try to be cool. And I grabbed my neck and I walked out, and I can't remember who it was. It was some skinny looking individual. I think it was some manager. I just kind of shoved him away and like, get out of the way, you creepy looking freak. And then I walked backstage and I sat down, and all my adrenaline wore off, and I felt like I was dying. I think I actually wore this jumper to the last show as well, so that's a little insight for the people watching the video. And then my exact thoughts were, nearly broke my neck. Should I go to the doctors? Nah. I'm a real wrestler. Gonna go drink. So that's what I said.
Something to be said about wrestling, just wrestlers in general. If your main goal is to go out there and batter each other for a bit and hope you're all right afterwards, there's definitely something a little bit different about the mindset of wrestlers in general. Sorry, I'm still laughing at the this must be what death feels like.
It cracked in like four places, and like, and it was so loud as well. I thought, right, everybody's must have heard this, and nobody did. I only heard the cracks, and then I've got it on video somewhere. And it was like my body kind of goes like, oh, and it was nasty. I look back at it and laugh though.
Well, I mean, because you're still walking, I suppose.
Yeah,
If,
well,
if
yeah,
you're...
that's true. My neck's still crunchy, but I come all right.
just it gives you that crick when you just do the stretching. It's fine. That's what men do.
Damn
Manly.
right.
So yeah, like you say, you weren't quite old school, cool yet. You were a bit more rampant. Did you get the usual advice from Glendon Barr? I've heard this is quite a common thing for first matches. Glendon Barr asking if you're nervous, and if you say yes, then this response is usually good, and it leaves you to that, like into the ether of fear.
I think I can't really remember, but I think everybody had asked me that day if I was a bit nervous. I was like, well, of course, but I'm a good level of nervous, because like I've worked so hard for this. Like, I'm nervous, but in a good sense. I remember like because Adam had came out first, and then it was me, and I remember there was a moment behind the curtain as my music was playing, which I couldn't really hear it because somebody had turned it down, and I was like, I just need to go. So, but it was an incredible experience. I remember. Like my family and friends were there to see me debut. Like, people from Eat Sleep Suplex Retreat were there because I'm quite pally with them, and it was the best experience of my life. And everybody asked me that. I think I lost count. Like 12 people had asked me that day, am I nervous? And I was like, well, I obviously, but I've got this. I'm fine. Like, and then I so.
So if anything, you asking me if I'm nervous, it's making me more nervous now. So
Yeah.
let's just carry on. I've got six matches to watch before I can go.
Literally, like, James, are you really, really nervous?
You mentioned Eat Sleep Suplex Retreat, and I've recently rejoined the ranks at ESSR. I took a big break because, my wife fearlessly gave birth to a child, and I did nothing, but I suppose I'm going to have to at least try doing some of the work afterwards. I'm glad to be back involved. How did you get introduced with ESSR? Was it podcasting initially? Were you just brought on the team? Did you know people beforehand? Were they part of the gym crew
Yes,
that left you?
I knew Kwaku. He was the ring announcer for Source at the time. I built up a good rapport with him, and I remember there was a, I think there was a tweet put out saying, "Oh, if you want to join, drop us a text." And I text Kwaku. I was like, "Mate, I love the wrestling. I want in this. What a day!" And then that was it. I had to chat to the people that ran it, and then I get in. So. Simple as that. So I'm their favorite wrestler. So I'm their oldest, schoolest, coolest favorite wrestler. So
I think I responded to the same ad. I think that's when I ended up going in, because I think we were both added to the group at the same time. But yeah, it's good fun. It's good fun to speak actual wrestling, because most of my life and my brain power is all Scottish stuff. So when they throw in a topic like, well, one, it's they'll be out right now for anyone wanting to listen to it. There's a Roddy Piper profile. It's just nice to go back and go, oh, cool. There's wrestling outside of Scotland that I can look at now. It's ace. Good team, good guys. Anyway, that's their plug. It's good. Go check out. So from that point onwards, so your initial gear was the white bike shorts, with your name on
Yes.
it. The What was the story with the kilt?
The kilt was, well, I'm very patriotic. I've got various patriotic tattoos. I've got, obviously, I've got a stag tattooed on me. I've got a Loch Ness monster tattooed on me. I've got a set of bagpipes tattooed on me. I've got a skiing do. So I'm very patriotic. I love the fact that I'm
Offensive.
Scottish, love my country. And my family's tartan, another wrestler, had it before me, and I was raging, and I was like, oh, God damn it. But first come, first serve, that's all right. It was Sean Fagan who had my family tartan, but he got it first, so that was fine. Funny enough, I did get to wrestle him, which I dubbed in my head Battle of the Kilts, because that was funny. See, like, my whole joke was who's got the better kilt, and obviously it was me. But I bought the kilt. I've still got it. I've still got my original white bikers and my kilt, so I could maybe interchange the two. Like, I've still got them. Like, oh, my new current gear is the red tie-dye with old school cool written on the back, and I love it. So, strangely, the comfiest pair of clothing I own. Like, I just cut about the house with them on, to be honest. I've not got them on today because I'm cleaning them, but they're fantastic. I got them off of M2M Pro Wrestling Gear, so highly recommend them. They're great. Cheeky wee plug there, sponsor me. So I've still got them. They currently sit with the kilt in my drawer. So I open up the drawer, just it pulls me back in slightly, but I'm putting the cool in old school, so I'll stay in the territories for quite some time. Will the Lion Rampant come back? Who knows? Maybe. Like, I'm enjoying this. And getting to cut about like this in the street's fantastic. So,
Well, that's what I was going to ask you. You've put away the kilt, you've put away the bikers, and you've embraced the old school cool, the more vibrant character, the tie dye, and a little bit more of a personality other than I'm right Scottish. I really like being
aye.
Scottish kin. So what was the inspiration? Did you just pull out? Was it a drawer you opened one day and there was a tie dye? Was the bandana there and you were like, no, this is calling me. I've got to be. This is me.
Well, the inspiration for old school cool was simply the fact that I love old school wrestling with all my heart. I am, and if you ask anybody from Source Wrestling, I spoke about Mid-South wrestling on an ungodly level. It's my favourite territory, also, just pointing out there. Like, I watch so much old school wrestling, like Mid-South, Mid-Atlantic, Jim Crockett Promotions, like World Championship Wrestling before it was then proper WCW. Like, I'm fine. And then, like, on the line on the YouTubes, like, I follow like Brian Turner's VHS like wrestling thing. It's like all these obscure like wrestling territories in America. And I don't get me wrong, some of them are absolute dishwater, but they're funny and fantastic. So, like, it was just that. It was like, I want to do something that's like more true to me. Like, the Lion Rampant had a purpose, and sure, but I really should have been doing old school cool from the get go because I love old school wrestling. And I thought if no one's gonna put like a Scottish spin on it, then I might as well do it. Like, I mean, like, I'm not, and also above all preference, like, I eventually will have a campaign out called "Save Your Knees." It's about how all Lucha Libre should be banned. Because, and I'll tell you for why. Now, sure, Lucha Libre is mighty impressive, don't get me wrong, right? It's well cool. I would do it. However, my two glorious knees, I want to be for saving so I can go out in different territories. Now, all these flips, all these cool tricks, they're hurting your back, your knees. I'm doing it for the wrestler's sake. Eventually, there'll be, I'll maybe dress up in a tie-dye suit, speak to the nation of pro wrestling and say, stop Lucha Libre, save your knees. Maybe I could make some t-shirts out of that to really spread awareness out of the Ban Lucha Libre fund. All plans for down the line. I'm still working at the legal aspect of that, but I'm getting there.
Oh, maybe one day. I mean, I don't mind it, but yeah, give me some wrestling, give me some wrestling
Exactly.
and
Yes.
character. You don't need flips when we can make a crowd go wild for a yes no chant, a Scotland England a high five, with the little claps at the start. You don't need a flip if you can do that. So one day, save your knees, SUK. We're gonna be on it. It's gonna be t-shirts everywhere.
Damn right.
So we're going to go to the questions because we got loads. I don't know if you've listened to any past podcasts. There's ones we ask everyone. We'll get to those, but there's plenty of other ones that we got sent through because Twitter was a buzz with some questions you may answer, some you may not, and laugh off, and we'll move on. We're going to start with the heel diggy, Scott, who asked
Oh
those
no.
questions on the Ruby Roberts podcast that we did. Sorry, I did, not we did. That I did. So we've got loads of questions here. So I think some of you just won't answer, but we'll carry on. Did you know you'd be more over in a mask?
funny enough, I had plans for a mask at some point. I had an idea. Like as I was rambling, I'd seen all the territory wrestlers with masks, you know, and I thought, now, oh, you see all these luchador geeks with their masks on. However, like a mask, pure professional technical wrestler would be right at it. So I had an idea floating around to be Mr. Caledonia for a while, you know,
That's amazing.
like the assassin Jody Hamilton. Very that same aesthetic, but I just punch people in the mouth, wrist lock, punch in the mouth, you know. So that could still happen at some point, might make an appearance, you know. However, you know, just so did you say it was heel diggy? Scott answered that question.
Yep, he's asked one of four questions. That's his first
Oh
one.
Christ.
But no, that reminds me of it was a Colt Cabana had Matt Classic as his alter
Yes,
ego.
it's
Oh,
his
that's.
best gimmick, and I'll die in that hell. Is that that is he should have been NWA World's Champion is Matt Classic.
You know, there's the clip for tag Colt Cabana. I'm sure you'll appreciate that. Right, so the other one is I think he asked this on the Ruby Roberts podcast. Do you fear Cheeks the Butcher?
I do not fear Cheeks the Butcher. Cheeks the Butcher fears OSC. CTB versus OSC will happen at some point, and let me tell you, like, screw your 5-star, your 6-star. This will be a 12-star match.
And he's also asked, can you ask your mum to leave me alone?
Scott, I swear to Christ, leave her alone. I is that is an inside joke between myself, myself, Scott, and Ruby Roberts are all really close friends. Obviously, with Ruby being my partner and all. But I'll be slapping him for that question, so don't you worry about that. I'll try and film it and I'll send you into the podcast. So.
I will put it at the end of the episode when you find them. Finally, a substantial one. That's literally what he's written. Finally, a substantial one. A favorite wrestling venue, and if you could wrestle anyone in it, who would it be?
I'd say that's a tough question. I'd say my favourite wrestling venue is, even though it's changed now and it's not the original one, Madison Square Garden. It's always held like a special place in my heart because like. San Martino won his belt there. San Martino lost the belt to Ivan Koloff there. I'd say I'd want to wrestle in Madison Square Garden. And if it was anybody from the past, I could probably give like an example of like somebody from the past and somebody from the present. I'd say I'd wrestle Mil Máscaras, so I could rip his mask off and take his IWA World Heavyweight Championship, which he still has. Like that, the International Wrestling Association's been dead for years. So I'd take that belt and take it to every other territory and I'd slap a tie-dye strap on it. At present, I'd say give me Ruby Roberts. Even though she is my partner, she's pound for pound one of the best wrestlers in this country. And if I get a batter, then so be it. Even though she's the strongest man I know. So it'll be a tough fight and that's why I want to wrestle her in that venue. You know, like first intergender match and my MSG would be excellent.
There you go. That's fair enough. Fair enough answer. So we've got more questions. So we'll keep going through them. Actually, before we do that, because a lot of them are kind of related to it. Somebody appeared in a video about TNA gut. Sorry, Impact Wrestling gut check. So from that point forwards, you did your debut. You appeared for Community Pro Wrestling as well. Some guy who looked very much like you was doing some refereeing. So your journey is ongoing. It's about year in. Year-ish into the business, and then Impact Wrestling gut check comes along, and of course we saw the tie-dye appear in that little clip video, and we saw blue hair as well, Ruby Roberts. What was that like? Was it just a case of you just had to go for it? And yeah, what was the inspiration for going? What was it like? How was your experience?
It was fantastic. It was a great opportunity overall. I went. I'd got my gear on. I'd stretched off. I can run through what we did. We we effectively we did like warm up drills and stuff, you know. It was effectively like we were doing forward drills. So there was they split. There was a really big group, so they split us into three groups, 24, I believe it was. And then it was when one person did a roll, the other person would roll, and then you'd roll again, and then you'd have to get out of the ring. So it was like a constant like elevator, and it was great. And then we'd ran some wrestling sequences, and then I took ages. Like, I wasn't picked. However, Scott D'Amore, president of Impact Wrestling, which is a total side note, I've never once called it Impact Wrestling. It was always TNA, and it was always TNA for me. Now that it's back to TNA, it made my heart happy. Said that I had good personality. So the president of the company said that I had good personality. So I'm running with that as much as I can. And I think I put it on Twitter that he said I've got good personality, which I, but you know, look at me, I'd scream personality. So like, but it was a great experience, and getting to do it with Ruby was fantastic, as well as other people that I've surrounded myself with. Looking Sharp was there as well. You know, he prepared us as best that I could for it. You know, so props to him for being a really good coach. But I'd happily do it again next year, and hopefully I'll be more buffeth, like the stuffeth, for it. You know, so all natural. You know, I'm not doing any roids. You know, I'm not allowed. You know, sake I know, but aye. So I'd happily do it again, or any other try to kind of speak today, for that matter. But I overall 10 out of 10 experience. Happily do it again.
I like that you keep saying you're not allowed. Like Ruby's going to go for a week to Europe and do one of her trips to Sweden or that. She's going to come back and you're going to be all buff,
Relax,
just like barrel chested, going, "Well, I thought about it and then you weren't here, so I just did it." And you
so I'm
know,
giving away my secrets, Billy.
but no, same thing about the TNA thing. That I went to my first press pass. The first thing I did was go, "Oh, thank you for letting me on the TNA Impact Wrestling press pass." Oh, no, I'm not going to get invited back on one of these. This is the end of me. And then, so I'm so glad that it's now TNA, because TNA was just, I stopped watching when, well, moved out to my own home and, well, moved out on my own. I didn't have Sky Plus or anything fancy, so if I missed it, I missed it, kind of thing. But oh man, I can't wait to see that logo appear up and hopefully go down next year and see them again, because I'll see them because I didn't go down this year. What a time. TNA. Jesus, that's was right. We've got questions about TNA, so let's get that. Manlin has asked, did you hit up TNA just to chase down Jeff Jarrett because his dad owes you money?
He owes me a lot of money, and I'm still trying to find him. But I'm getting there, though. Like, I'm so close to finding them, but then he keeps vanishing. Honestly, he's like a wizard. Strangely, like, I thought I'd be able to find him better, but you know, I've been scouring Memphis, and the slippery son of a gun. I just can't find him.
Like Jerry Jarrett. Ah, oh, how dare he? We've got, well, he asked, Manon's also asked, miss you, big guy. We'll always have you have that old jab strut combo from back at Source.
For context, we were in a match against, I think it was at the time, Big Mick, and I can't remember. I don't know if he's changed his names, like the, you know, the Scout Master, the guy that was cutting about
Oh, yeah,
like
he's
that. Scout the Bastard, I think was his name actually. So it was Big Mick Scout Bastard against me and Manlin, and we grabbed Scout Bastard and just kept jabbing him and jabbing him. And on the third strike, bang, hit, like clockwork, bang. Just started strutting. It was perfect.
Speaking of that guy, I think he was Jack Ranger for a minute, and now he's Dip Donaldson. I think if it's the same
Oh,
guy we're
right.
speaking about, but
I see it.
I didn't know who he was, and I got the results in for a show. I think it was BOP, they're called now. Bless my
I
dad,
hate
but
him.
and but I got the results through, and it was Dick Donaldson, and I read it and went, I can't be right. I had to go and
All
check
right.
with someone else, going, is there, have you got a guy called Dick Donaldson? And they went, no, he's called Dip. Oh, okay, that makes more sense. Let's go for that then. Dip Donaldson said, well, I'm just going to call this guy a dick for no reason. Anywho.
He is a dick. He's a scout bastard, and he knows it. He knows what he done to me.
We've got Sean Moran with a bunch of
Oh.
questions as well. He's put, is it true you wrote the song Old School Cool Start in Heaven for one of your fans?
For legal reasons, my lawyer says I can't divulge the answer, but no.
There may be that might be a question, an answer that you use a couple times then. Is it true you're meant to be the lead in The Wrestler?
Yes, however, that dastardly Mickey Rourke beat me at the last minute as I was sick with the flu that day, so the role was nearly mine. But unfortunately, he'd got it over me. Still a wonderful movie, though.
So you tell me there could have been a case we would have seen Old School Cool against Chris Jericho at WrestleMania if it wasn't for Mickey Rourke.
Yes, and wasn't for my illness. Yeah, you know, that one too many rum cocktails, brother, you know, had me floored for days.
And the final question that Sean Moran's put in is, could you ask your friend Terry why his wife looks a lot like his daughter? Feel like he's just trying to get us sued.
Or me. I don't know why Terry Boulder is asking. I don't know. He's weird, right? I don't know. Like, did a lot for the wrestling business. Dog shit human being. That's the only way I could describe it. Like, I might be old school cool, but I've got standards. I've got morals.
Plus, took away the six sides. Took away the six-sided ring. Even though
Exactly. Absolute bastard.
every wrestler that has said that wrestled and hated it, it's still Hogan's fault. Took it away, and Bischoff. Yeah, fuck him as well. Right. So, Bischoff's the kind of guy who'll probably check these as well. You know, nerd. Zach Atlas asks, "Who is your favorite fearless hero?"
Me,
Fair.
right here, numero uno, old school coolest. Me, I'm the bestest hero. Like, it's me.
There we go. And one final mention of the Impact gut check. We did get a question on Instagram, which was just Judas Gray going, I don't know, generic gut check question, I guess. So there's his mention for the episode. I still feel quite bad after accusing him of being very twilighty in a recent episode. He is though, isn't he? He is
Aye,
really twilighty.
he's very shiny. I don't know why.
you go for the spark. I was right. It just seems like, yeah. It'd fit in with Collins. Not that I've seen the films. They're shite. Right. Our questions that I ask everyone, who ought to win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
I'd say, well, two sheep or one cow. I'd say for cows being naturally bigger, larger animals, I would say probably the cow. However, you then have to count the fact that the two sheep could be biting at the ankles. So I'd say I'm putting my money on the cow for this one.
Just noting down, James Blair, wrong. Right, okay. And another question, another question to ask everyone is, what's your favorite dinosaur?
Ruby Roberts, because she's 73.
Oh, God, you're dicing with death there.
Well, if you find me dead, it's you know why, so.
Because she left the house and you're on steroids. Got it. Right.
Not
so from
giving
that.
away my secrets.
So from this point, so we've done all the questions, we've divulged now, we've started kind of your wrestling journey, up to Community Pro, and what was it like making your debut? You'd spent most of your time, or just about all your time at Source, but make your debut for Community Pro, which is, I don't know if it was a Govan show, or it was Johnston, was it? Can't remember. But it's a different crowd, it's a different environment. Ravy Davey has somehow poisoned all the children that come to his shows, like a gas as you come in. Because they're feral. But what was it like making your debut for our company?
It was fantastic. I've wrestled for a few other companies that I've wrestled for, W3L, and for getting to go for CPW, it was great. I actually got to wrestle on my birthday, back in September, and it was great. It was myself and the VLs, the Vicious Lads. Well, CVLs, I dubbed this because it was cool. Vicious Lads versus the pack, and that Renzo Rose, I told him Renzo Rose recently had just won the No Limits Championship in OTT in Milan, so props to him. However, he told me to eat shit. Now I've wrestled Renzo; he's very good. However, sure, he won that match. He didn't pin me though, and I get the better of him the majority of that match. So, if Renzo wants to run his big mouth, then I'll happily wrestle him anywhere. I've told him this, but. You know what? I don't care if it's in Scotland or England or Ireland or Milan or in my back garden. I'll wrestle Renzo Rose any day of the week. And break him into a.
Shave sideburns, you know.
Yeah, right. Like, take a pair of scissors. Shave your sideburns, match like a bit.
That's it. I mean, as soon as I saw Renzo, I'm not very familiar with Renzo. I've become more familiar now. He's appeared for Community Pro because, you know, Scottish bubble. I'm very hard to get out of it. But yeah, as soon as I saw him, I saw the sideburns, I was like, oh, well, those are a thing. You better be good at wrestling if I'm gonna have to look at those sideburns for so. Grow a whole beard or dinner. Just make up your mind.
Like,
Sorry. It's...
don't half ass it. Full ass one thing.
That's it. The old Mike Herman Trump method. But yeah, so here's the, so the overall message here is Renzo Rose, you're an amazing wrestler, but you're lazy. Grow a beard.
Yes.
Right. So from up to, yeah, you made your debut in companies like WTL. I'm assuming that was Gallows because I find it so difficult to get WTL results anyway. They're like elixir, they're gold, trying to find them. So WTL, Community Pro, what's next for Old School Cool? Have you got things on the horizon that you can discuss? Have you got?
I think so. I know hopefully next year I should be creeping into APW, so Attitude Pro Wrestling. I'm trying to get a hold of the Wanderer, prove to him that old school's cool and that, and if we tagged we could be old school Wanderers. But hopefully I'll be creeping in there at some point. I hopefully will be back at CPW sometime soon. And as the standard with wrestling, I'm gonna go to shows, put my name out there, face it there. I'm sending CVs, left, right, and center, as it is with the wrestling, it took me ages to figure out a CV and to do it on the line, I was still working on carrier pigeons for a while, but eventually I figured out how to work out this whole email malarkey. But I'd say one place I really want to get into is Target Wrestling, for one man, DCT. My original match for Source Wrestling's grand finale. It was supposed to be at one point a line that was rampant versus DCT, but plans changed, and I was that close to wrestling one of the greatest wrestlers this country's ever produced. I don't care where it's for, and it's not for the fact that oh I know I could have beat him. It's none of that. I need to prove to myself that I could hang with somebody on that level and not look like a fool for wanting to creep into that upper echelon of professional wrestling. I'd wrestle him anywhere, no matter the promotion. So he is at the top of my list, as well as the likes of CG West. Is like he's master of the axe handle, and I'm king of the and I'm the grand master of the power slam. So it's battle of the old school right there. And then there's Renzo Rose, because I want to make him eat his words. So, but hopefully I'll be wrestling all over soon. It's just one of those things, I know wrestling tends to slow down a bit during this time of the year, but you know what? I've got things in the horizons. I'm also still trying to figure out who the hell shot my cousin Jimmy.
That's what I was about to
He's
mention. Yes, I was in there. We did get one final question. It was from the Scottish signing
Ah,
on
she's
Twitter.
lovely.
Asking any ideas who shot your poor cousin Jimmy the ref at CCW. So is that your entry into Copenhagen Championship Wrestling, is to get to the bottom of this to find out who shot Jimmy the ref?
I mean, if it have me, then 100% yes. I keep trying to fire the emails, however, it keeps getting lost. I know they're going to Valor soon, which hopefully I'll be able to creep into there in the next year or so. I don't know who shot Jimmy, because Jimmy's a lovely lad. He's doing well in his recovery. I know at the last CCW show, he was doing the commentary with Golden Boy Charlie Anderson. Who Charlie's lovely, is also, if he's listening, Charlie, answer your phone, brother. I've got things to talk to you about. Planting them seeds, brother. Then I'd say, if I was to speculate though, because my cousin, like I said, loveliest guy, always trying hard, always helping out, does those 1-2-3s well, good, right? I'd say, his best friend Stone Malone had recently just joined God's Country with Frank of the Cross, Sister Lestrange, and Tim Strange. My sister Veronica, rather. So I could say, as an act of sheer utter betrayal, Stoney Maloney shot Jimmy the Ref. However, I've no idea. He's who I speculate for right now. It was very dark in the Opry, it's a little bit hungover, so I couldn't exactly see who shot Jimmy the Ref, but I would imagine it's him, or it's, I don't know, the Yeti. It could be anybody, but my money's in Stone Malone.
There we go. There's the. I mean, it's all allegedly. Allegedly, just in case anyone does
Don't
want
sue
to.
me, allegedly.
There you go. Allegedly, I mean, we're already getting sued by Eric Bischoff for me calling him a dork. So it's all good. We'll add that to the list. I mean, it would have been dark in the venue because you got sunglasses on. I mean, that wouldn't have helped the case. But no,
Obviously.
I'm glad to hear Jimmy the Ref is doing okay, and he's on the road to recovery because we need more good people that can do the three counts. It's a very difficult job. I've heard. I've seen people do it badly. So there is that. So moving forward, actually pro wrestling you mentioned, and hopefully Valor, as they'll be called next year. Is there anywhere else that on your journeys around the territories that you've visited that you think a little bit of old school cool wouldn't go amiss in this particular promotion?
I'd say W3L. They've had a lot of old school wrestlers on there, Tracy Smothers, Joey Legend, those like. So I think I'd fit right in W3L. I know that like any promotion that'll have me, I'll happily work for. I know that my number one main squeeze, Ruby Roberts, is doing quite well at SWE now. So I keep sending carrier pigeons to her to send them my CV. However, they've not got back to me yet. But I'd like to say, though, that at some point I could creep into SWE or W3L or more CPW stuff, or some places down in England, But I'll wrestle anywhere that have me. See, as long as, I've got, space to hang, and dry out my bandanas and a place to hang my glasses, I'm all right. I'll wrestle anywhere,
Is that the same for opponents? Then you mentioned ECT being one that you've got your eye on in Target or wherever you can get your hands on them. But do you have a bucket list of opponents that you'd want to work your way through?
Yeah, I do actually. I wrote the list like a while ago. And they've not really changed much, but the DCT's at the top and CG West, like I mentioned previously, and Renzo Rose. But I'd say Big Gabe, they're like big game hunting. They're the top echelon that I want to face and prove that I can hang with. I'd say and you laugh at this one because I hate the traditional flippy wrestlers, the ones that are all flips and can't work, But I'd say El Hijo del Santo. I'd love to rip the mask off the Son of the Saint. The most prolific luchador in history was El Santo. Get given a state funeral, a massive statue for his gravesite. To rip the mask off of the Son of the Saint would be excellent, or Blood Demon Jr. Or any luchador for that matter. Actually, Sammy Sparks, he's quite annoying. I'd like to rip the mask off him and slap him about something rotten. Who else would I like to batter? I'd say the Pack, I still have to get my victory back on them. I know that I can't. Oh, what are their names again? But I know there's the Renegade Reject, and then there's Nathan, what a loser. So any of the Pack boys I'd wrestle any day of the week in twice on Sundays. So Ruby Roberts as well would be excellent. Like I mentioned earlier, she's great. And she's strong. When I say she's strong, she's freakishly strong. We wrestled a little bit at the gut check, and it was a great experience. However, she threw me so hard, I thought I was gonna die. I've got to put over my partner, but she's so freakishly strong, it's scary. So she bye. Who any? I'm trying to think. DCT at the main day, at the end of the day, DCT. I was this close to getting it, and it took away from me like that. So he is at the top, and he knows this because I've told him before that I was gutted it never happened, but I know it would happen down the line. But if you don't ask, you don't get. So to any promotion, I'm calling out DCT. I don't care where it is. I don't care whether you can only pay me in pennies, you can only pay me in pound coins, you can only pay me in alcohol, pay me in them steroids. Don't do that. I don't care where in Scotland or England or Ireland or all over the country. I couldn't care less. I need to wrestle DCT to prove that I put the cool in old school cool.
I don't think we can go any higher in our episode with that declaration to face DCT. So you mentioned you had some technological issues in the past, the old one finger typing as you go, carrier pigeons. But if anyone wants to find out more about old school cool, where can they go?
They could find me on Twitter, or the Bird Machine as a James Blair underscore one. They can find me on the Instagrammies as James Blair underscore old OSC. If you find it hard to find me, the picture of me, Community Pro like that is my profile picture. I'm on Facebook as well as James Blair OSC. The OSC is in all caps. Please follow me on all the on the media socials. I'm still actually trying to work on the line, but I'm getting there. You know, I'm getting there slowly but surely. You know, but you know, I'm not on the ticky talkies or that. I'm not doing it. I cannot stand the ticky talkies, so I'm not on there at all. I don't care how much Ruby tries to push it on me and tell me, oh, it's great and all that. I'm not doing it.
I know. I only started posting again on TikTok to get the Disney 100 cards, you know, because for some reason I got a couple and I was like, this is nice. I'm gonna get some more. And I suppose it's like steroids. They're moorish, but like crack. Right. So from going forward, thank you very much for taking the time to out of your vitamins, prayers, working out, and everything in between, visiting all the territories and smacking mask wrestlers in the face and saving their knees. This has been I've enjoyed this chat with James Blair. But again, thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me today.
Thank you very much for having me.